From the dark, balmy, breezy, rolling hills of South Central Florida, just above the Everglades, this is Far Out Radio. I'm Scott Teeters. Today is Monday. It is March the 16th, 2015. Hope you had a good day, a nice weekend. Well, it's re-entry day. It's behind us now. Time to kick back and dive into some Far Out Radio. Lawyer, author, historian, theologian, philosopher, and 32nd degree Mason Robert W. Sullivan IV is our guest tonight. We'll be talking about his new book, Cinema Symbology, A Guide to Esoteric Imagery in Popular Movies. Yes, we are going out on the skinny branches tonight. And when we're done, you'll never again watch movies the same. Now, we're not trying to spoil your movie-going experience, but you should know what you're looking at. I mean, after all, it's right in your face, literally. Cinema Symbology connects the occult, numerology, astrology, mythology, alchemical, tarot, and Kabbalistic symbolisms contained in popular movies. Cinema Symbology analyzes The Exorcist, Back to the Future, Star Wars, Episodes 1 through 6, Lord of the Rings, The Wizard of Oz, Black Swan, Monty Python and the Holy Grail, the James Bond movies, The Matrix, The Shining, and many others. And the book is a big boy. It's 503 pages, published by Rocket Science Productions. And it's been out since June 28th, 2014. Of course, it is available at Amazon.com in print and in Kindle format. However, if you would like to get an autographed edition, you can buy it from Robert's website. We'll give you the website address in just a few minutes. So, all right, well, let's head on out to those skinny branches with our guest, Robert W. Sullivan IV. Hi, Rob. Welcome to Far Out Radio.
Hey, Scott. Thanks for having me on. It's great to be with you tonight, and I appreciate you having me on Far Out Radio.
Well, I saw your book listed on, gosh, we get updates from a variety of publishers, and I saw the book in one of the catalogs, and I went, oh, this is a good one. I got to get this guy on. Now, earlier today, Rob, you were telling me that Cinema Symbology had its beginning in the last chapter of your first book, The Royal Ark of Enoch, and the final chapter was titled, So Dark, the Con of Men, Masonic and Enoch Symbolism in Cinema. Now, many of the movies that you talk about in Cinema Symbology were films that you saw as a child, a teenager, and a young adult. Were you subtly aware back then that scenes and images had meanings, or did you one day have an OMG experience?
Oh, no, it wasn't. I didn't realize it. You know, when I was growing up as a child in the 70s and 80s, oh, no. I mean, I was not aware of this at all. It really didn't click in. It kind of was like an OMG moment. I would say that probably happened in the early 2000s for me when I was, you're right, I was writing The Royal Arch of Enoch, and you know, that was basically a book of 20 years of research, but it really was around and you're right, the final chapter of The Royal Arch, Royal Arch of Enoch does delve into some of the, you know, Masonic and Enochian symbolism. So it was really around 2003, 2004. I had seen and was aware of some of this stuff beforehand. Like, I knew the Star Wars movie with the monomyth with Joseph Campbell. And I had, you know, when I was studying the material to put into the Royal Arch of Enoch, you know, all this occult, esoteric, mythological, you know, astrological, Kabbalistic, you know, symbolism contained within Freemasonry, the Blue Lodge, the High Degrees, I was kind of sort of applying it to movies I was watching. And the one that really triggered it was the National Treasure movie with Nicolas Cage, mm-hmm. The first one. That was when it really kind of the bulb went off that this is a Masonic ritual I'm watching on the big screen.
Mm. Yeah, that was really in your face on that one. You couldn't miss that at all. I thought the beginning of it was really cool. I really liked the beginning of that movie.
No, go ahead.
Well, since you cover such a wide range, time-wise, a wide range of films, one of the films that I was looking at the list of the films in your book that you analyze, and to put some time perspective on this topic, where I'd like to start is with the 1939 classic, The Wizard of Oz. Now, the book was political allegory, and I think that for most people that watch the movie or remember the movie, for most of them, it's just a fantasy story. So when did people begin to catch on to what you refer to as the initiation into the mysteries? Because that's not something I was aware of, and I've seen the movie many times.
Right, absolutely. I became aware of that when I began researching the author. The guy who wrote it was a man named L. Frank Baum, and him and his wife were members of a organization called Theosophy, which was founded by a Russian mystic named Madame Helena Blavatsky. To make a long story incredibly short, she was, it's essentially neo-Gnosticism. It is what it is, for lack of a better word or words. But it's, you're correct. You have the idea of it just being the, you know, girl going on an adventure, you know, yada, 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 thanks for coming. Then you have this entire political allegory going on, which I also talk about in the book, which is a reflection. The book is really, or the story is really a reflection of 1895 to 1905 political, yes, socio-economic allegory in the United States. But then you have this much more deeper, you know, symbolism going on within the Wizard of Oz, where you have initiation into the mysteries, the girl being transported to a magical land to receive revelation or gnosis or knowledge or wisdom, which for her is that there's no place like home. You know, and you have the idea of her going up the winding staircase, the ladder of ascension, which is for her the tornado, taken to the magical land, which is beautiful, but it's ruled over by the evil ogre, the monster. I mean, you'll find this paralleled with Jack and the Beanstalk, where he goes up the beanstalk to the beautiful land that's ruled over by the monster. This comes straight out of the world of Gnosticism. This creature is called the Demiurge. It's the lesser god. But at any rate, to receive gnosis or wisdom, she walks on the golden path of enlightenment. And of course, this leads her to this false messiah. And this is part of what Theosophy sort of warned about, was that organized religions were suspect and could also often lead to false worship. And then, of course, Blavatsky, another thing that was interesting is Blavatsky said to be initiated into the mysteries, you had to have intelligence or wisdom, fortitude and strength. Of course, Dorothy is joined by the three travelers who are all seeking this. So you have a very, a theosophical Gnostic theme going on in The Wizard of Oz, initiation into the mysteries. You'll find this exact same theme paralleled in Lewis Carroll's Alice in Wonderland, and you also find it in the Alice Siebold book and movie, The Lovely Bones. Those three stories really, really echo each other.
When you were researching the metaphysical, mystical aspects of The Wizard of Oz, did you find any indication that people were tuning into this back in the early 40s when, you know, well, the movie came out in 1939, late 39, but when did people start to catch on that there's something else going on in this movie?
The political allegory, you know, was somewhat well known. That was somewhat well known at the time. I think the whole initiation into the mysteries, I can't tell you precisely when that became out. I could just tell you that in my research, you know, I discovered it in the process of writing the book and writing the Royal Arch book and just doing, you know, the voluminous amount of research. The political allegory is kind of somewhat more obvious and on the surface. You know, with the wizard being President McKinley and the scarecrow being the American farmer and the tin man being the laborer. I get into this in the book as well. It's interesting, but that was somewhat more well known. But, you know, the whole idea of it being this, for me, the idea of initiation, and again, you'll find this in the Alice in Wonderland story, which is really almost the same story. You know, and Lewis Carroll was into this same sort of material as well. For me, it was really, when I got tipped off to this was when I discovered that Baum was a member of the Theosophy movement. And you'll find this often a lot of times with authors who write these books or these stories, and then it gets turned into a movie. You'll find it out with Ian Fleming, who was surrounded with the occult and mysticism. Of course, Baum with Wizard of Oz. The other one that jumped, you know, Lewis Carroll with Alice in Wonderland. He was involved with very metaphysical societies. Oh, and then, of course, the other one that, you know, screams off the page is people like Bram Stoker, who wrote Dracula. He was involved with a secret society called the Hermetic Order of the Golden Dawn. And within Dracula, you'll find it on the screen in a lot of the big screen versions. I know you have the whole Vlad the Impaler thing, but you'll find this very, very embedded, very secretive idea of Eastern mysticism intruding on Victorian Christianity going on in Dracula. So, when you research the authors of this stuff, you'll find their source material, and that's a good tip-off that, the material they're writing, and which is ultimately made into the movie, contains this, you know, arcana.
How involved was Frank Baum in the mysticism?
Oh, yeah, I mean, him and his wife were initiated or members, full-blown members into Theosophy. Okay. And again, this is a sort of a neo-Gnostic group. It was founded by a Russian woman named Madame Blavatsky. It incorporates a lot of, comparative religion, you know, study of mysticism, the occult. She wrote numerous books on this. The two biggies are Isis Unveiled and The Secret Doctrine. And Baum and his wife were full-fledged members. I couldn't tell you specifically, you know, how long. I mean, I documented in the book when their membership took place. But I mean, they were very much into this, and you know, it was really sort of a secret, not a secret society, a society dedicated to the pursuit of arcane wisdom for self-improvement, self-betterment, explaining the mysteries, things of that nature. And Baum and his wife were both members of Theosophy.
Okay, well, that's a pretty strong involvement. I mean, a lot of famous people have been interested in metaphysics and mysticism. Certainly Elvis Presley was a spiritual seeker. He spent time at the Theosophy Center there in Beverly Hills. But he was just a seeker in general, and he used to like to read books. I like to read books, too, but I'm not involved in any of the organization. But some people really do get involved in it. Another person from... a famous person, of course, was Jack Parsons, who was the rocket guy. And his name is often associated with Aleister Crowley. However, Aleister Crowley, we had a fellow on who wrote a book about Aleister Crowley. Crowley's perspective on Parsons was, this guy's a nut. So, you know, they were associated, but they weren't necessarily that connected. But it definitely sounds like Baum, Mr. and Mrs. Baum were very connected. Poor Frank Baum's movie. Frank Baum. The movie kind of bombed financially. It got great reviews, but it didn't make a whole lot of money back then. They only made back on it about double what they spent on the movie. Just amazing. We have our music playing in the background, Rob, so we're going to roll into our commercial break. If you're just joining us, our guest is Robert W. Sullivan IV, and we're talking about his latest book, Cinema Symbology. The book is available at Amazon.com in print and in Kindle format, as well as his other book, The Royal Ark of Enoch. And you can follow his website at Robert W. Sullivan, and then IV for the fourth, RobertWSullivanIV.com. And when you go to the website, if you want to get an autographed book, you can get one right from there. We'll be right back in just a few minutes. Robert W. Sullivan IV. Hi, Rob. Welcome to Far Out Radio.
Hey, Scott. Thanks for having me on. It's great to be with you tonight, and I appreciate you having me on Far Out Radio.
Well, I saw your book listed on, we get updates from a variety of publishers, and I saw the book in one of the catalogs, and I went, oh, this is a good one. I got to get this guy on. Now, earlier today, Rob, you were telling me that Cinema Symbology had its beginning in the last chapter of your first book, The Royal Ark of Enoch, and the final chapter was titled So Dark the Con of Men, Masonic and Enoch Symbolism in Cinema. Now, many of the movies that you talk about in Cinema Symbology were films that you saw as a child, a teenager, and a young adult. Were you subtly aware back then that scenes and images had meanings, or did you one day have an OMG experience?
Oh no, it wasn't. I didn't realize it. You know, when I was growing up as a child in the 70s and 80s, oh no, no. I mean, I was not aware of this at all. It really didn't click in. It kind of was like an OMG moment. I would say that probably happened in the early 2000s for me when I was. You're right. I was writing The Royal Arch of Enoch, and you know that was basically a book of 20 years of research. But it really was around. And you're right, the final chapter of the Royal Arch of Enoch does delve into some of the, you know, Masonic and Enochian symbolism. But it was really around 2003, 2004. I had seen and was aware of some of this stuff beforehand. Like I knew the Star Wars movie with the monomyth with Joseph Campbell. And I had, you know, when I was studying the material.
face, literally. Cinema symbology connects the occult, numerology, astrology, mythology, alchemical, tarot, and Kabbalistic symbolisms contained in popular movies. Cinema symbology analyzes The Exorcist, Back to the Future, Star Wars, Episodes 1 through 6, Lord of the Rings, The Wizard of Oz, Black Swan, Monty Python and the Holy Grail, the James Bond movies, The Matrix, The Shining, and many others. And the book is a big boy. It's 503 pages, published by Rocket Science Productions, and it's been out since June 28, 2014. Of course, it is available at Amazon.com in print and in Kindle format. However, if you would like to get an autographed edition, you can buy it from Robert's website. We'll give you the website address in just a few minutes. So, all right, well, let's head on out to those skinny branches with our guest. From the dark, balmy, breezy, rolling hills of South Central Florida, just above the Everglades, this is Far Out Radio. I'm Scott Teeters. Today is Monday. It is March the 16th, 2015. Hope you had a good day, a nice weekend. Well, it's re-entry day. It's behind us now. Time to kick back and dive into some Far Out Radio. Lawyer, author, historian, theologian, philosopher, and 32nd degree Mason Robert W. Sullivan IV is our guest tonight. We'll be talking about his new book, Cinema Symbology, A Guide to Esoteric Imagery in Popular Movies. Yes, we are going out on the skinny branches tonight. And when we're done, you'll never again watch movies the same. Now, we're not trying to spoil your movie-going experience, but you should know what you're looking at. I mean, after all, it's right in your